Hello, my name is Dr. George Barrio, and along with Dr. Burton Scott, we will review some important aspects of Huntington's disease. Financial disclosures to note as shown. Dr. Scott is on the Speaker Bureau for Lundbeck. Our goals for this presentation are as follows. We will review the historical aspects of Huntington's disease, review the known neuropathology and correlated clinical findings, discuss the genetics and how this correlates with diagnosis, and finally, what we can do to manage these patients. Huntington's disease was likely first described in the late 1300s as the dancing mania. A few other reports over the course of the next few centuries was noted, but it was George Huntington's eloquent description of this hereditary chorea that led to the designation of his condition as Huntington's disease. Interestingly, it was published in 1872, just a year after graduating from medical school, as a paper titled On Chorea, seen here. This ended up being only one of two papers that he ever wrote. A general overview of Huntington's disease is shown here. Huntington's disease is an autosomal dominant progressive neurodegenerative disorder with a distinct phenotype that will be discussed in the next few slides. Huntington's disease has a stable prevalence in most populations of Caucasians of about 5 to 7 affected individuals per 100,000. Exceptions can be seen in areas where the population can be traced back to a few founders, such as Tasmania and Venezuela. The rate is much lower in most of Asian and African populations. The mutant protein in Huntington's disease is Huntington, based on chromosome 4, which results from an expanded CAG repeat, leading to a polyglutamine strand of variable length at the N-terminus. How the CAG repeats affects Huntington's gene is debated. Evidence suggests that this tail confers a toxic gain of function. However, the precise pathophysiological mechanism of Huntington's is poorly understood. What is known is the affected Huntington protein leads to inclusions within the nucleus, cytoplasm, leading to destruction of the cortex, but mainly a very selective area of the brain called the striatum, which is composed of caudate and putamen. Specific neurons in these areas being most damaged include striatal and nigral medium-sized spiny neurons and large striatal interneurons. Moving on to clinical findings. It is important to note that Huntington's disease can have an adult and juvenile onset. Adult onset, which is the more common form, has onset of symptoms between ages 35 and 45 but can occur at any time in a patient's lifespan. Juvenile onset are typically below age 15 but has been reported as early as age 2. A majority of juvenile onset patients have similar symptoms as adults, but some can be more vague, such as a decline in motor milestones or school performance. The triad of symptoms of chorea, behavioral changes, and dementia are the three most characteristic findings seen in most Huntington's patients. These findings can occur together or precede the others by many years. More information on the classic triad. Chorea, meaning to dance in Greek, is defined as a sudden onset of purposeless, involuntary dance-like movements. Chorea can initially progress in the disease, but then with later onset of dystonia and rigidity, can become less prominent. Also, clinically, chorea is commonly integrated into the patient's baseline mannerisms to minimize this abnormality. Another second finding is of dementia. Interestingly, the cognitive decline in Huntington's disease often spares long-term memory, but impairs executive functions such as organizing, planning, checking, or adapting out alternatives. These features worsen over time, with speech deteriorates faster than comprehension. The final symptom of this triad is of psychiatric disease. Depression is typical, and suicide is estimated to be about 5 to 10 times more than of the general population. Manic and psychotic symptoms can also develop. Another finding in Huntington's disease that contributes to patients' overactivity is motor impersistence. This is the inability to maintain a voluntary muscle contraction at a constant level. Some examples of this include milkmaid's grip, which is described as squeezing fingers with contraction and relaxation of grip with inability to maintain a constant grip. Other findings include issues with fine finger movements and, most notably in patients with juvenile Huntington's, slowed saccadic eye movements that are usually prominent with need of turning the head briskly to look to one side is characteristic. Death in patients with Huntington's usually occur when motor and cognitive deficits become more severe. Patients usually die due to complications of falls, poor nutrition, infection, or suicide. The common life expectancy from onset of symptoms is typically between 15 to 30 years. The diagnosis of Huntington's in the past has been purely clinical by patient's history, especially family history along with physical examination. Since the onset of genetic testing, this has become an increasingly important in confirming the diagnosis. Genetic testing evaluates the CAG repeats on chromosome 4, and the interpretation are as follows. A patient with 40 or more repeats has a fully penetrant disease, meaning they will develop the disease. 36 to 39 CAG repeats states a reduced penetrance and the patient may develop the disease. 26 to 35 CAG repeats are indeterminate, and less than 26 CAG repeats are considered normal. Other findings that can help in diagnosis is imaging. MRI and CT evaluation in patients with moderate to severe Huntington's show loss of striatal volume and increased size of the frontal horns of the lateral ventricles. In this image, atrophy of the caudate leads to appearance of the classic boxcar ventricles. It is important to note that scans are usually unhelpful for diagnosis of early disease. On to management. Unfortunately, despite numerous trials, no clear treatment in humans has been shown to stop or slow disease progression. There are several drugs on the horizon that in animal models have slowed progression and have promise for the future. For now, treatment is symptomatic. Treating psychiatric manifestation with appropriate meds, including SSRIs, will work well in patients with Huntington's. Chorea can be treated with either neuroleptics or tetrabenazine if severe. Other therapies including maintaining adequate nutrition with dysphagia screening, appropriate therapy services including physical, occupational, and speech, as the patient's condition progresses, offering caregiver support is important. Genetic counseling, if occurring prior to having children, and to discuss the risk of passing down the mutation to each generation, must be considered. Finally, the long-term planning focusing on future disability, goals of care, and if needed, institutional care with hospice and other end-of-life issues. With that, we can complete our discussion on Huntington's disease. A few parts to remember. Huntington's is an autosomal dominant neurodegenerative disorder whose genetic basis is on chromosome 4 with CAG repeats on the Huntington gene. The classic triad of symptoms include chorea, dementia, and psychiatric disorder. Use of genetic testing now has made the diagnosis easier to make by quantifying the amount of CAG repeats. The use of imaging and findings of caudate atrophy with change to ventricles can be seen in severe disease. And finally, management is purely symptomatic at this point. Here are the references if you desire to learn more about Huntington's disease. Thank you for your attention.